Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausen Pereira. The COVID-19 crisis has a potentially far-reaching, long-term negative impact on children and women around the world. The impact is likely to be devastating, especially for children, even though they appear to have less severe symptoms and lower mortality rates than other age groups. More than 1.5 billion students are out of school. Widespread job and income loss and economic insecurity among families are likely to increase rates of child labor, sexual exploitation, and child marriage. Stresses on families, particularly those living under quarantines and lockdowns, are increasing the incidence of domestic violence as well. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze the impact of COVID-19 on children and women. Joining me on the program today are Gotha Haripriya Karthik, Family Life Coach, Lalita Kumaramangalam, former chairperson, National Commission for Women, and V. Rajalakshmi, sociologist. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Ms. Kumaramangalam, I'd like to begin the program with you. Let's first analyze and try and understand the kind of impact that the coronavirus pandemic has had on the lives of women and children in particular.
Frank, let me start by saying that, you know, we should not look merely at the economic impact of the virus. The fact that we are all stuck at home, most of us are stuck at home, the vast majority of India, and the fact also that many of us do not have access to the internet. The mobile phone is there. The government of India and all over the world, we talk a lot about our jam trinity. Now, the mobile phone is there, yes. But especially for students who are no longer in school or in college, I think the older students perhaps may have a little, in terms of education, a little better, but the younger students are finding it very difficult. India has, the south of India has its holidays from April and May, north has June and May and June. So actually for most of North India, school holidays had not yet begun. Students, as you know, nowadays get promoted to the next class about a month before school closes for summer vacations. So a lot of things have gone haywire. Examinations, those that have been held, I think they're finding it very difficult to correct the answer sheets. For those that were postponed, students don't know what is going to happen and when it's going to happen. Fees is another problem, which is both reflected on the parents and the children. If we don't pay the fees, how do the schools pay their teachers, etc., etc.? If you don't pay the fees, considering that many parents who are sitting at home are not getting full pay, especially if you talk about migrant labor, etc., they're not getting any money at all. How do they pay their fees? All of this is reflected in a change in the priorities of the family. And you find that normally it is the women and the children who bear the brunt of it, especially the girl child. Now, you already mentioned sexual exploitation and child marriage. Now, sexual exploitation takes place when you are the most vulnerable. And children, especially girl children, but also nowadays, I'm told sometimes boys also, end up being sexually exploited because they're sent in as casual labor. Casual labor itself has taken such a hit in this country. But as the government has no choice and will start slowly opening up the economy, you know, bit by bit, it will probably be the migrant labor or the daily wagers, as we call them, who will be given some sort of priority, and MSME sectors, etc. Now, the government is, I think, looking at asking for guarantees from the employers. But, you know, there's only so much that a government can do. You will see that there is also a huge amount of prejudice that's going around, especially with regard to those who may have come from even COVID hit areas, so-called hotspots, etc. And I don't know, it's very difficult to battle psychological and mental prejudices, far more difficult than to battle physical thing. Also, so far, most of India has been able to hold down the numbers of those infected. But you'll see that Delhi and Maharashtra and Gujarat are in the last 3-4 days, it's getting frighteningly large for India. Given our 1.36 billion population, all those ratios you will look at, fine. But then we also need to remember that our health system will not be able to take even 1/10 of, you know, what could be a full-blown epidemic. Now, one of the things that women and children are facing now is increased levels of violence, whether it's sexual violence, whether it's mental and verbal violence, whether it's physical violence, both within the house and without. Children are very vulnerable. So are women. And whether it's working women or women, you know, who are now staying at home, or women who are housewives, the space that most of us are used to, our own little spaces that modern life has taught us to get used to and that we expect to be a part of our daily life, that has gone. Now, where women were in marriages or in relationships where there was always a problem with violence, they are in much worse shape, because most women do not want to complain to the police. People will say, go to a counselor, go to a police. One, you can't get out of the house. Two, many of these don't have access to things like Wi-Fi, internet, etc. And three, they are in very much closer and much more, constant proximity to their abusers. So where do they go? Most women don't even have people they can talk to. Now, right. Automatically you take it out on your children. It's a human instinct. I'm not saying anybody is bad, good. I'm passing no judgments here. But I'm saying that given how the situation is, children often bear the brunt of their parents' problems.
Absolutely.
Or the discord between the parents. So there are multiple problems that children are facing. And discord between parents does not happen only in poor or marginalized families. It happens all across. It has nothing to do with economic status, education, religion, etc., etc., etc. Right? I could tell you endless stories of violence that women and children have faced, which are out of South Delhi, which is considered one of the most well-heeled places, and out of Bombay, parts of Bombay that are really rich people.
Right.
And it has nothing to do with it. Now, the problem also is that India has too few counselors. We have the NCW, when I was chairperson, even before that, we had started a program where we had trained counselors who sat in the police stations. It's called the CAW cells, the violence against women cells. But that's in the police station. How do you get to a police station? One, and two, women don't want to go to a police station. Three, children have no access to the police station. They don't even know their rights. So basically, the human rights of both women and children are being grossly violated now. And there seems to be very little attention that's paid to it. I'm glad that, Rajya Sabha has brought up this thing. I've been talking myself hoarse to a lot of people, including journalists who are friends. Everybody is talking about Islamic phobia, Hindu phobia, this phobia, that phobia, all of it. Nobody is talking about the violence that women and children have suddenly been forced to face. And they don't know what to do about it. There's no avenue available for them to even vent their feelings. Much of which could give them some moral courage, a lot of things. They have nothing to fall back on.
Let me take the point that you're making forward with the other panelists as well. We Rajalakshmi, we've seen a rise in domestic violence since the pandemic broke. Now, what does this say about our society as a whole? It's not just in India. I mean, all over the world, this is happening.
Yeah. See, one of the most important thing is that as students of sociology, we say that nothing is more important than the human interaction. So if whenever there is a human interaction, or human interaction is very essential for the overall mental development as well as the physical development of a human being. Now in this lockdown, what is happening is that we are suffering from both the angles. Now if you look at the working women, from a middle class, see, the effect is of course there for our classes. But if you start, say, talk about the middle class women who has to manage both her work and the domestic work. So there is a double burden. Now, for people like us who have been going to colleges and all, so what we used to do was we leave our household work for the maids to do. Then whatever little work we could do it in the morning, we used to do. And then once we were back at home, we could manage with the others. Now what is happening is that you need to first, there is a new kind of an experience for teachers, because it's the first time that teachers have been asked to conduct online classes. So once we do this online classes, it's quite stressful for us also, because we are not used to this kind of one-way interaction. However much you try, it rarely remains one-way interaction. There's never a two-way reaction. Many times when people ask the teachers that year after year, you teach the same syllabus, is it not boring? Then we say that no, it's not like that. Why? Mainly because every time you get a new audience who react to things in a different manner. So then, therefore, what happens is it becomes a two-way interaction and two-way learning. Now with one-way learning, most of the teachers, or for that matter, many of the people who are not used to taking this kind of classes, get very stressed out. Now right. comes to the families. Like what happens is every individual, whether a man or a woman, require a certain kind of a space. Mainly because whenever there is any kind of a conflict or any kind of a difference of opinion, or for that matter, when you feel like, reflecting on what has been happening with your life, day-to-day life, there is always a venue out. So you go out of the house and you try to unwind yourself. Now, that kind of unwinding is not happening these days because of too much of, staying at home or lockdown. The other very important thing is what happens is, of course, in the initial days, it was very good. So one felt that in an urban life where all the time you're struggling to go from one end to the other and managing so many things, it's a good opportunity to be at home, to know your family members. But after a point of time, what happens is the pressure that is from both the sides, from your side and from the other members of the family, becomes too much. It's like overloaded electrical bulb, too much charge with too much of interaction, that it tends to burst or fuse out. So that is also happening. And then of course the problem of insecurity, uncertainty, anxieties, all these things are adding up. Now in a patriarchal society like us, where the man of the household is not expected to do the work, because the burden of the household work is usually shared by the women along with the maid. Now, since the maids are not coming because they are also at their own houses, what is happening is expecting a man to do all work along side by side is actually a big and a huge task which a lot of people are facing. It's good. I mean, I'm not saying that men don't work. They are been working. They're also trying to help out. But the kind of natural risk, taking the responsibility, doing a work, doing with responsibility are two different things. For a woman, it becomes very essential to take care of both domestic work and also trying to manage with her own career or rather job responsibilities.
Okay.
So managing both the things, double burden is something which is really creating a lot of anxiety, stress,
and
waiting for things to come. I just want to say one more thing. As far as the students are concerned, that is young people are concerned, those who have to take admission or those who are almost like reached a stage where the next stage is for them to take admission somewhere else, they are under great stress. And since there's no entertainment for them, all the time getting directions from the parents is also making them making their life, or you can say they're quite unhappy and feel that they're really bounded. So these are some of the things which I thought I'd
share. Sure, okay. Let me take these particular points that you're making forward with our family coach on the panel right now. Haripriya, how do families cope with a situation like this then? I mean, this is your area of expertise, your specialty really. Tell us, how do families cope with situations like this?
It's been traumatic, I should say. Okay, traumatic, stressful, and filled with anxiety for all members of the family. I specifically focus on toddlers, age group of 0 to 7 years. But off late, I've been getting a lot of calls about couple therapy, couple counseling, because clearly it is created a lot of strain between the husband and wife per se, between grandparents. So all the situations that we've been clearly avoiding for so long has been come out of the carpet, and it's there sitting in the house, center of the house. As far as kids are concerned, I clearly see a war-like situation for them. Like they are literally like there is a war going on. They're not allowed to go out. Their entire routine is taken off. So we always say, the remedy or the medicine for stress and anxiety is more connection, more attachment. So clearly now they have lost a lot of attachment. They are with their families, yes, but a lot of things that they were attached to, their schools, their environment, their play group, just their peer support, everything is taken off from children also. So they're going through a lot of struggle with the attachment, part of it. So now the pandemic is it's even more dreadful, because the remedy that we give for stress and anxiety is attachment. And now clearly we are telling everybody to not be attached to anybody, to be alone, to be in separation. So that creates, it just worsens the situation. It's like one domino you tick and everything just falls. That's how children are, and they are getting on to the stress of the parents. All parents are in a lot of, even adults are in a lot of uncertainty, anxiety. So children, very young children can catch on to that so quickly. And they're listening to the news, the conversations that we're having. Pregnant women especially are going through severe stress because they can't go out, they can't meet people. And in our country, in our culture, pregnancy is to be celebrated with people, with a lot of, societal interaction. True. Everything is taken off from them. And they're in constant fear of all the news that they hear. So I'm looking at this from, you know, how we're affecting the next generation also, how this is, taking its impact on the person in the womb also. So, you know, that's what is happening. And children, they listen to these tiny, tiny conversations. These young children who cannot comprehend the magnitude of the situation, they think their parents are going to die. That's what they're hearing. What is the death toll? How many new cases today? And they can't process this with tiny brains. So it's very difficult. And how do they do it? They take it out as a tantrum. They get aggressive. They seek for more connection. And already the parent is stretched out that they cannot give anything more from them. So literally we see islands of people living in the same house who are not able to connect. So we see one family unit, great, everybody is together. What is the anxiety? Everybody is together. Yeah, we're all alone together. That is what is there, because we have no outlet, no place to connect, no way to fill our cup. So that's what I see every day in the work that I do.
Okay. All right. Taking the discussion forward now, I'm going to ask my panelists to be brief because we spent quite a bit of time on our opening remarks. You know, so okay. Ms. Mahavangla, are you worried at all that the worst is still to come? Do you believe that the lives of women and children are only going to get worse going forward after what we've seen over the last 1 month or 45 days?
Well, to be brutally frank, I'm afraid for a little while it could probably get worse. It probably will. Because when the economy takes a hit, it's always women and children who are pushed back, especially the girl child. Even now, patriarchy exists all over the world. It's not dominated by India or Asia or anything like that. Wherever you go, you'll find similar stories. And patriarchal norms are that women get everything last, whether it's food, whether it's life, whether it's clothes, everything, sustenance, everything, even healthcare. And that is where there are going to be a lot of problems. Also, I'm afraid that there is, and forgive me for putting it so bluntly, there is going to be a sort of population, mini population explosion past this phase where we're all stuck at home together for obvious reasons. Okay, I don't mean it again in any sort of judgmental way. But it's a very human expectation. And I don't know what sort of world those children will be born into. The truth is that everybody seems to think that the COVID is on its way out already. But the fact is that there is no cure. And until there is a vaccine, and that vaccine is made available to everybody, which is next to impossible in the whole world, there is always going to be this problem. Of course, many of us may well develop some sort of immunity, etc. But large parts of the world have very low immunity to viruses. Remember that in the US, lakhs of people die of influenza every year. In India, we think, what? The flu? Nothing. We'll get over it in a week. So, you know, if you're talking only about India, I could say some things. But you're talking about the whole world and women. I think women are going to be, unfortunately, and especially the women's equity, you know, everything that we talk about now, I think may well be very drastically, affected in a very negative way.
Okay.
People maybe like me and Priya and Lakshmi may not see so much of it because we are educated, we are independent, etc., etc., urban women. But a lot of women all over the world who have no other resources but to depend on their families may find themselves pushed back about 10, 15 years.
Okay. All right. Since we're here then, you know, Rajalakshmi, let's talk about what needs to be done really as far as couples are concerned, as far as parents are concerned, as far as children are concerned as well, because they are they're like sponges, like Hari Priya was just telling us, you know, they can very easily absorb everything that's going on around them. So, you know, what do we do in a situation like that?
I tell you very frankly, it is very difficult. Why? Mainly because at least for some few more months to come, even if the government decides to open the lockout for many other reasons, at least the schools and the colleges will not start, at least for a few months to come. So therefore, it will be a very tough for the women to take care of the children, their energy and their mental stress and anxiety. Most important thing, again, I mean, I would just want to add on to what ma'am just said, that apart from all that, what is also going to be a very difficult thing to cope up is the unemployment. When it will come to unemployment, the first thing, I think women will be more affected.
Yes.
Yeah, unemployment, when this all this problem will come, I think women will be targeted more than the men. Two, also in a family, it becomes very difficult to have a person who is not working. Man, if he's not working, the ego hassles might also be there because, you know, it's very difficult in a patriarchal society to accept a woman going and working and a man not working. Two, a lot of women who have been, who are self-employed, of course, will have a lot of tough time in trying to care about all the generations who are at home. So keeping all these things in mind, if you say what is the way forward, how things are going to be, it is very difficult to say. Why? Mainly because each individual is different. Every class has got its own problems and issues, and every section has a problem. And in a society where we have always given too many roles to women to perform at home, you know, too many roles to perform, it's going to be too much thing required. I mean, too much of counseling is required, and unfortunately, that counseling is not there for her outside. So keeping all these things in mind, I really don't know what to say and comment saying that what is the way forward. So it's a very difficult thing to say.
All right. So let's talk about another aspect completely. You know, Haripriya, since you deal with toddlers, since you deal with young children, there is so much of talk about children spending a lot of screen time. You know, children spending too much of time online and how it could have an impact on them going forward. Do you, what's your take on that? I mean, unprecedented times, do we allow children to go online to get some screen time? Is it a good thing, bad thing? What's your assessment?
My assessment, it's definitely a bad thing, a very bad thing. I'm somebody who believes that children should have zero screen time till 7 years of age. Okay, but come on, let's get realistic. Okay, so I get so many messages, so many calls saying my entire family is home and they're watching TV and they're on the phone. I don't know how to protect my kid because we create a lot of awareness about screen times and the adverse effects that it has on children and the young brains. So, you know, I get a lot of frantic calls saying, what do we do? So first, when these people already know how harmful screen times are, I just tell them to chill because these are really challenging times for the child, for the parents. So for now, let's focus on keeping the sanctity of the house because, you know, sanity and the sanctity of the house because clearly there is no help for the parents also. They're working from home in most cases, or the mother is fully engaged in household chores. So there's clearly nobody to be with the child, give their presence. I don't even mean engaging with the child or playing with the child, but just the mere presence has become a luxury in so many homes because in the urban setup, most of us have shifted to a nuclear setup where only two people are there with the child. So, you know, it is a very a tricky phase, a cat on the wall kind of a situation. Do we allow them? Do we not allow them? I tell them, just go with the flow. Have a limit on a particular number of hours per day, at least. Like, say, let's say 1 hour, half an hour, 2 hours. Just have at least that limit so then you can go forward from now. But after things settle down a bit and when we get back to our normal life, things will continue being different. And there's another tricky part because now all classes are online for kids. You know, pre-KG, LKG classes have started to come online. I'm wondering why are, you know, LKG, UKG students being taught online? What is the necessity? They can wait for another 2 months, but looks like the schools, you know, want to give them lessons and all. So we can't do anything about such screen times because it becomes educational now. Okay, absolutely. So that's
I don't think it's just the schools. I find a lot of young parents say that we paid the fees. And, you know, the children are doing nothing but sitting and watching TV and they're on the computer. So please let them at least, you know, keep them occupied. I've actually heard this. My own daughter has said it once to me. I said, what on earth are you saying? She's seven, for God's sake, my only grandchild. So I dote on her, you know, obviously. So I was having an argument. She said, no, you're so far away. You just keep quiet. She's always watching TV. What do you want me to do? Let her at least, you know, and she loves learning. So let them give her some classes. Let them take painting and all of that. So it's not just the schools.
It is the parents as well. Okay. All right.
I totally agree with you, ma'am. There is another point to this is that, you know, the teachers are pressurized to do their work because they have to justify their salary. So they have been constantly told that this is the...
We are paying you a salary, do your job.
You need to report. You know, so in order to report what they have done, they've overburdened the students. As I said, it's a really a very, very difficult situation. Why? Mainly because one, the students are pressurized. Two, the teachers are pressurized. Three, the parents are pressurized. And then together, all are pressurized in this.
Okay. All right. Time now to get quick closing remarks from all my guests with the best way forward. Starting first with you with the... with the best way forward, Ms. Kumaramangalam, you know, do you believe that the policy makers have a tough time with their hands going forward?
See, the policy makers will have to first look at health and the economy. Without that, the country is going to really suffer much more worse. But I think that employers have to start looking at not only the economic health of their employees, but also the mental and psychological health. So, of course, will the health ministry of the various states and the central government. And I think after this scare, possibly governments will start investing more in health. Look at it as an investment into the future. And that is where I think activists and, you know, ladies like Lakshmi and Priya and me need to come in and say that health has to include psychological and mental health.
Men too, of course.
There are activists who are men also who do this work. Yes, I agree. I accept your point. So activists have to, and of course the media, so that includes you anyway. The media has a very, very big role to play here where we start talking about mental health. In India, mental health is a very taboo subject even today. And that has to be part of, you know, the way going forward. The economics of it, everybody knows about it. More than enough people talk about it. But the pressure on mental and psychological health that the epidemic is putting needs to be brought to the front, and we have to pay special attention to it. Right. For example, even on the teachers, it's not just, you know, parents and children. It's the teachers, everybody who works with children, the caregivers, the IRs, all of them. When they go back, everybody's going to be cranky. Parents are going to be tense. Children, it's going to reflect on them. You like she said, they're sponges. They imbibe everything without us even understanding it. And so a lot of patience is going to be needed going forward from every section of society.
Right.
Government is always under pressure, state and central. So, I mean, but I think families, communities, you know, people on the street, for example, who are our neighbors, all of us, we need to, our approach needs to be a little softer and more gentle towards each other. Empathy is going to be very important, I think. We need to pay attention to that.
Absolutely. V. Rajalakshmi, the best way forward. Very quick answer because I've got limited time.
I totally agree with ma'am saying that most important thing is to take care of the mental and the psychological health of each and every individual. And I feel that certain sectors like education sector or other sectors need to sleep a little bit. I mean, if it's a lockdown, let it be a lockdown. Let's not put too much of pressure on, you know, doing your job and getting your job done. And I think that is very important. And even if one is expected to do this online job and, you know, be true to your job, I think it should slow its pace. I think that it should be kept to rest for some time. And because most important thing is that we need to be strong individuals and we have to come out very strongly after this, whenever the life becomes normal. So that is very, very important. And of course, most important thing is that by now people must have realized that housework is very, very important and it should be valued, since most of the times housework is not valued and people are not respected for doing housework. I think the attitude should change, and I hope it will change.
Absolutely. And Aripriya, close the show for us with your concluding remarks with the best way forward.
Okay, so I agree with the both of them completely, 100%. And my thought is that, you know, we should all come out like this, like how we would rehabilitate after a war. It should be taken that seriously that, you know, we should all be educated about the trauma, the stress and the post-traumatic stress that happens after we come out of this, especially PTSD. On children. Somehow, you know, these kids are always, you know, like they're not even part of the society, like pregnant women. These kids, they're just not even part. They're just, you know, like invisible to us, and somehow now we focus only on the men, the women and the economy and, you know, finance. Yeah. So my hope is that the government will look into this seriously about the mental health and the psychological health of young. And for years to come, we keep looking out for symptoms in them, and we train more people to deal with you know, this anxiety and stress that crops up.
Yeah. Okay, all right. On that note, then we'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program
and
putting things into perspective for us. That's it on this edition of The Big Picture. See you again next time.
Good night.
Bye. Bye.